Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. And a special welcome to Paul and Elaine and Alice, who are visiting with us this morning. It's lovely to have you. Well, we've had a cold night and a beautiful morning in front of us. So let's hope that puts us right in the mood to worship and remember why we're here. I haven't got any notices because they're all on the pews news, so you don't really need me to announce any. But I'm sure that today we'll be especially thinking of all the families where children are going back to school after that long break, an end to home teaching and a new start. And we pray that everyone, especially the children, will keep safe and well, and that we are really seeing our way out of this wretched pandemic. And so we praise God for the progress that's been made already, and pray that it will continue. And so we'll begin with a sentence from Psalm 51. We've got a little bit of a focus on Psalm 51 today. And it says, "Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow." So please, Lord, do that for us. As we pray, we come together, trusting in God's mercy and love, longing to know and to learn more about God's ways. We come to be guided in the ways of God's truth, to experience the joy of God's salvation. We come as we travel on our Lenten journey, aware of God's steadfast love, helping us to overcome the trials and temptations which can descend on us at any time. Lead us, O God, to do what is right in your eyes, and teach us to follow the humble ways of Christ, your beloved Son, our crucified and risen Lord. Amen. And now we'll have a prayer for Lent set to music. And we'll return to that beautiful prayer again later in the service. Nikki, thank you for leading us in our confession.
Thank you. Wasn't that lovely and peaceful? Let's just take a moment to come before God now. Just thinking of the times perhaps when we've not acted in the way perhaps that would have been best, but perhaps we've put our own interests above those of others. Compassion and forgiveness belong to the Lord our God, though we have rebelled against him. Let us therefore renounce our willfulness and ask his mercy by confessing our wrongdoings in penitence and faith. Please feel free to say this along with me. Most merciful God, whose Son, Jesus Christ, was tempted in every way, yet was without sin, we confess before you that we have sinned. We have hungered after that which does not satisfy. We have compromised with evil. We have doubted your power to protect us. Forgive our lack of faith. Have mercy on our weakness. Restore in us such love and trust that we may walk in your ways and delight in doing your will. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We're now going to hear our second hymn for this morning. Well, the first one wasn't really a hymn, was it? But it was just a lovely, quiet introduction. So now we have a hymn called Above All.
Have a moment to take that in before we turn to our collect for this Sunday, the third Sunday in Lent. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And so now we'll say part of Psalm 51 together. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me.
Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Amen. And now Tony will give us our reading for this morning.
Our reading this morning is taken from Gospel of St. John, reading from chapter 2, Jesus cleanses the temple. Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show for us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Tony. So to many of us, every year, the coming of spring is an unfailing sign of the faithfulness of our God. It should also be a reminder of the covenant between God and his people, and that's us. And of course, for us, Lent is exactly that. A time of reflection, not only about our Lord, how much he gives us and what we owe him in return, but also about ourselves. If we give up, say, wine or chocolate or biscuits, it's good for our health. But it might not be and should not be what it's all about. It has to be truly and selflessly sacrificial. It should be about obedience and keeping ourselves on the path that Jesus has shown us. Jesus the Jew, who came not to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. Jesus, whose sacrifice is the reason for the darkness of Good Friday and the light and joy of Easter. The Old Testament reading for today, which I haven't chosen to include in this service because it's familiar and quite long, but it's about the giving of the law by God to Moses. We're all familiar with it. The Ten Commandments were given in fire and thunder, and they were God's instructions to his people of how to live his way. They were pretty comprehensive too. I'm reminded of that old Jewish joke that when Moses came down the mountain, he told the people, "The good news is we've got him down to 10. The bad news is adultery's still in." Well, the law's not a joke, of course. But joking is a human reaction to something that is almost too hard to get our heads round. And the problem with the law was and is that everybody fails. Absolutely everybody. And so everyone needs forgiveness from God. And in a nutshell, that's why Jesus came. That's why Jesus died. But back to humanity. The other thing that spring brings is much more mundane on the face of it, spring cleaning. Whether cleaning the house, clearing out the shed or valeting the car, there seems to be an irresistible urge to get into those dark corners and get rid of the dust and all the things that have been hidden away and neglected, and to let the light flood in. Wait, am I still talking about housekeeping? Yes and no. The old saying that cleanliness is next to godliness still holds true. Don't we feel great when we're done? But let's look at what Jesus was doing on that fateful day in the temple. Now, John tells us that this event happened shortly after the wedding at Cana and just before that year's Passover. He speaks of our Lord making a whip and taking it to the money changers and traders in the temple courts. The other gospel writers set just such an event as happening at the Passover of the week leading up to Jesus' death. They have no record of a whip or of the religious authorities challenging Jesus until a day later. Were there two events, or was John making a different point in his telling of the story? Well, a clue to the length of Jesus' ministry on earth comes from John's mention of three Passovers in his gospel, where the synoptics only speak of the last one in Jesus' life, on his final journey to the cross. They tend to focus on the story as being one of a protest by Jesus against the misuse of the temple. John, however, seeks always to reveal something of Jesus to us. And in his story, the disciples hark back to Psalm 69, verse 9, which says, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The theologian Richard Burridge suggests that this may have been less of a protest than a sign for the zeal of Jesus for his Father's house, which would eventually lead to his death. So in all the Gospels, the event or events were a foreshadowing of Jesus's death. Well, Jesus drove those money changers and traders out of the temple courts. He swept away what had been ignored and neglected, bringing in a renewal and refreshment of his Father's house. But that did not go unchallenged by authorities. They wanted to know what gave Jesus the right to do what he did? And he answered them with a riddle. If they destroyed the temple, he could raise it again in 3 days. Well, his questioners took this quite literally and were offended. Yet they knew their scriptures. They could have remembered the prophet Hosea, referring to one who would revive the people in 2 days and raise us up on the third. They had a chance to open their eyes and ears and see who Jesus really was, but they weren't listening, and the chance passed them by. The temple sacrifices would be replaced by the cross once and for all, but they would not see it. For us, with hindsight, there are opportunities to look both back from that point to the prophets and forward to the death and resurrection of our Lord. So for us, who are ourselves his earthly temple, Lent is an ideal time to look for opportunities in our faith and worship which need to be replaced by the new order Jesus brought. Are there dusty corners to be cleared out and possibilities for renewal? Are there traditions which could be brought into the light, aired and renewed? For those of us who, like me, are steeped in the Anglican tradition, this can be very difficult. But if nothing else, COVID-19 has forced us to find new ways of worship, new ways of showing our love for our neighbours, maybe even new ways of thinking about our faith and the way we express and share it. Is this a time for renewal, a time for fresh thinking? Well, let's ask God that question and listen with hearts and minds for his answer. Amen. And now we'll turn to our next hymn, which is How Great is Our God.
Age to age. great is our God.
And now let's affirm together those things which we believe. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we'll return to our Lenten prayer and just look at it again before Roger leads us in our prayers.
Lent is a time for spring cleaning our lives, a time for assessing how closely we are following Jesus, how far the temples of our body are dedicated to God, identifying which tables in our lives need to be turned over so that we are brought back to who we are meant to be. Lord of Lent, your Son was angered by injustice and championed the poor and downtrodden. As we come to the end of Fair Trade Fortnight, we too should feel angered that in our world today, wealth inequality continues to grow. With the 8 richest people now as wealthy as half the world's population. Bless the leaders of the nations and inspire them to work for the good of all people. Sweep away from them all self-seeking, corruption and deceit, that they may challenge every inequality wherever it is found and overturn the tables of injustice. Bless those people who have dedicated their lives to the eradication of inequality. And show us all ways in which we can play our part, however small. Lord of Lent, renew our lives. Lord of Lent, come to your church and help us to face pressing and difficult questions. Are we as a church faithfully proclaiming your gospel? Are we demonstrating in our life together the justice of your kingdom? Have we welcomed the weak and the poor? Come to us, your church, and spring clean our ways of life, our structures, and our priorities. And so we pray in the words of Psalm 51, make us a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Lord of Lent, renew our lives. Lord of Lent, look with compassion on those whose minds are filled with anxiety this morning. We remember particularly those whose mental health is affected by lockdown, those who are lonely and in despair. Give them your peace and comfort. Remove all fear, guilt, and self-hatred by turning them into trust for you. Help us to cast our concerns onto Jesus, who alone knew the experience of extreme suffering. Lord of Lent, renew our lives. Lord of Lent, turn your healing love towards those who are sick and in pain, especially as a result of coronavirus. We bring before you those especially known to us, family, friends, church members, or those in the news. And in silence, we name them before you. Give them, we pray, your healing touch. We remember now with gratitude all who have departed this life and now live with you on another shore and in a greater light. Support those who mourn, that they may know your comfort and peace. Lord of Lent, renew our lives. And finally, we pray for ourselves, that you will overturn all those things in our lives which does not honour you. Show us those sins in ourselves we may no longer even notice. Clear away all that holds us back. Cleanse our hearts and renew our minds. During this Lent, we pray that our minds, bodies, and spirits will become a temple for your presence. So may our words and our actions speak only of your love and truth, so that all we do will serve to reveal your gospel to the world. Lord of Lent, renew our lives. Cleansing Lord of Lent, renew our world, renew our church, and renew our whole lives. Amen. We sum up our prayers in the words that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So we come to our final hymn, which is a paraphrase of Psalm 42, and it speaks of our longing for God. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs for you, O God.
So could I just take a moment to thank everyone who's been involved in our worship this morning. It's been a truly lovely time together, very thought-provoking. So thank you to everyone. I know it's not easy, so thank you everyone. I'd like to end with a final prayer before a blessing. Lord, our minds seek to know you. Our hearts long to find you. Our souls desire to serve you. Send us out aware of your presence, that our hearts may be renewed, our minds refreshed, our souls restored, that we may reveal you to others and know you ourselves. As Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And a blessing. God is among us. Shout the good news. God is ahead of us. Trust the good news. God is within us. Live the good news. So go now as light bearers to a world in darkness. Go now as hope carriers to a world in despair. Go in the name of Christ, in the love of God, and in the power of the Spirit. Amen. So let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.